But let's talk about some big tech real quick before we go get into the Super Chat segment. I got to talk about this. This is huge news.
Oh, yeah.
We got this from Timcast.com. Neutral video platform Rumble to go public with an initial enterprise value of $2.1 billion. Rumble's skyrocketing viewer engagement is a promising sign. Yeah, it's true. It is a promising sign. Basically, they're doing a SPAC, a special purpose acquisition company, through the Cantor Cantor Fitzgerald. That's what it's called. They say CF Acquisition Corp, CFVI, is a global financial services firm led by Cantor Financial Chairman and Chief Executive Howard W. Lutnick. It's a SPAC, meaning it has no commercial operations and exists only to raise money through an initial public offering. It exists with the intention of merging with another company. So we know that it's going to be merging with Rumble. The company will then become Rumble, effectively allowing Rumble to go public. But it also then does bring in this other institutional investment firm as people with power over Rumble. I think there's some really good things here. There's also some really bad things here. And the first thing I'll say is, man, Ian, did you call it?
Dude, get ready for State Street, BlackRock, and then what's that other investment firm, the other big one?
Blackstone? I don't know.
No, it's BlackRock, State Street, and there's a third one that's huge. Why? They're all going to put 8% into this company. Get ready.
Mm. Why would not these big, you know, BlackRock and whatever, why wouldn't they be like, oh, yeah, we'll buy shares?
Yeah.
Oh, it's public traded now?
Look at Apple, Microsoft, Alphabet. You see BlackRock, State Street, these same investment firms own like 7 to 8% of almost all these top companies. It's crazy. They just get a little bit, so it doesn't look like they have too much control. Mm-hmm. They got a little bit of almost everything.
First, I'll say the good. It's great that there is competition to YouTube. It's great that Rumble is growing. These are net positives, but I don't think it's a long-term solution. If now with Rumble's supposedly going to have, I think, what did they say, $400 million in proceeds.
Oh, wow.
Rumble will receive approximately $400 million in proceeds, a combination of a fully committed pipe of $100 million at $10 per share and $300 million of cash held in the trust account of CFVI. I don't know how much they'll be able to spend, but if this means that Rumble can then go to prominent individuals and say, how much do you make on YouTube? And they go, oh, I make, you know, $10,000 a month. And they say, we'll give you 11. Move to Rumble. And they'll go, done.
Is it that easy? Don't you have to like spend all this time and effort building audience and all that?
You do, but I mean, look, one of the biggest problems with competing with YouTube is that Google subsidizes YouTube. So they're putting way more money in than the platform actually makes. They're effectively doing just that. Stay on our platform, you're going to make all this money based on your viewer count. Rumble can counter that, and they did by basically doing deals with people. We'll give you X years at X amount of money to produce content on the platform. Then we'll help, you know, it'll help us grow. We'll help you grow, put you on the front page. That can be really powerful. What Rumble needs to do right now with this money is they need to buy billboards. And I know it sounds silly and it's archaic and silly, you know, old school, but you need that mainstream presence where regular people are going to see Rumble. They're going to see Glenn Greenwald up on a billboard on Sunset Boulevard or in New York. And that means something. That means Rumble is mainstream and it's not that expensive to do, especially if they have this. So that's the good here. Here's the bad. As Ian pointed out, all of these big institutional investment firms are going to get their pinkies in it very easily. It's publicly traded. Once they have enough control, Rumble is done. People say, yeah, but look, Chris, the CEO, Pavlovsky, is still going to be involved. And full disclosure, I've talked to him. I digitally know him. I've never met him in person. And I said, yes. And when I worked at Vice, Shane Smith, the CEO, controlled the board. And that became a feminist company in a couple of years after they took investment from large institutional investment firms. Vice had investment from other places before I got there. But when Disney came in, when Fox came in, and these people invested, and then he said, "Don't worry, I control the board." It took 2.5 years, and the company became woke feminist.
And like a CEO, what's his name again? Chris Pavlovsky.
Pavlovsky.
Chris probably used to calling all the shots. He walks into the meeting, he says, "We're doing this, we're doing that." And now I know he's still a majority shareholder, so I think he still has board control, but
meaningless.
He's going to be surrounded by people that are harping on him every day. He's going to get tired of those meetings, and then he's going to want to get out. I'm not saying that's going to happen, but that's usually what will happen. Using attrition to get you out. I just looked up Alphabet shareholders as of December 20th. This is the company that owns Google, that owns YouTube. Vanguard is their top investment holder. So it's State Street, BlackRock, and Vanguard, these three investment firms. Vanguard's got 6.4%. BlackRock is 5.5%.
They're going to get in the ground floor, man. It's going to be pennies in the dollar.
And those three companies own about 20% of your company. If they collude, I don't know. I've never seen proof of it. But
it's not that. It's what I was told by someone who is a former executive at Vice. The reason they got woke was because the investors all came in, and even though they didn't have majority power or anything, they said, we have enough power on the back end outside your company. You need to do this now. And they were like, all right, we'll make the changes. So first, I'll break down the worst of it. Dave Rubin's promises are worthless. Dave Rubin, after Patreon, do you remember Patreon banned people, that whole thing? So he goes to these creators, people like Michael Malice, you know, and he says, look, join my platform. You know me. You can call me. We're not going to ban you. You know, we know, you know what this is all about. We're going to make a safe place. Well, then locals sold to Rumble. Dave, I don't know exactly what his position is, but he's like, no, nothing's changed. He's like, I'm still involved. Like, we're not going to ban anybody. But now anything he promised you is meaningless because locals is owned by Rumble.
Yeah.
So now it's Chris. Do you trust Chris? Well, I never had a deal with that guy. Like, so maybe you're someone on locals. You're like, I never talked to that guy. I don't know who he is. How am I supposed to get a hold of him?
Right.
I guess I'll still maybe Rubin can still help me out. Now they've done this public SPAC deal, and they've got institutional investors involved as advisors, for legal advisement and financial advisement. And as Ian pointed out, why would not these big firms be like, hey, a massively expanding company that gained 8 million users in a month, I'm in, right? Mm-hmm. A lot of people might want to buy into that. And then all of a sudden they're going to say, my bottom line is being threatened because you're hosting X content or Y content or Z content. And then what happens now? What happens now when the institutional investors are involved and all of a sudden your locals account gets nuked? That would be really bad for their business. So I don't see it happening anytime soon. But it says to me that what I really don't like is that following the crisis of Patreon and the censorship, Dave Rubin went to a ton of people and said, trust me. And then it was 2 years later, he sold that and his promise is gone. These people, they own their data. That's what Dave says. Yeah, well, good luck getting 2,000 to 5,000 people who have subscribed to your platform to leave and know where your new platform is. You get locked in. You're giving a percentage of your income to them, and their promises became worthless the moment they sold the company. Mm-hmm. Now they say, oh, don't worry. Chris is, you know, he's going to retain majority control. Great. I've seen that happen before. It's meaningless. These companies get in, they invest. It doesn't matter. They've opened the door and said anybody who wants in can get in. And that means anyone who opposes free speech can simply just, George Soros, he could be like, all right, I will buy whatever I can buy.
He'll buy like stock in a bunch of companies that'll buy stock in.
That's right.
Yep. So it'll look like 12 different companies, but Soros owns 6% of each of them or something.
Bill Gates likes to do that too. So there's Koch brothers, but then they get into the ESG social corporate credit score, and then they are really put into a place where they have to comply or they lose all of their funding, lose all of their money. And that's really where they get a lot of big corporations.
So is the fear that Rumble is going to be YouTube in 5 years?
Yeah,
Rumble's going to be bought by Alphabet in two. That's my fear, is that Rumble's going to get bought by Microsoft. It's probably not too far.
Well, they'll probably be looking at antitrust lawsuits if they do. But like,
I would hope so.
Why? And I hope not. No. Like, I really don't. Like, here's the thing. Like, we're in a market economy. There's probably half a dozen or more, a dozen competitors to Rumble that we haven't even talked about yet. Like there are solutions
Odyssey,
to this.
BitChute.
Yeah, and you know the video space much better than me. You know, hopefully Rumble recognizes that they have value in allowing different voices on their platform. And here's my hunch, like YouTube so far has navigated this. You start kicking off enough people and choking their speech, you're going to lose not just your audience, but the people producing the content. How much are you publishing on YouTube now?
So we do, I think, probably close to 3 hours every day.
Okay. Well, that's a lot.
And we do put a lot of, we do use Rumble, and we use, and we also post on BitChute and Odyssey. And look, like, this worries me for the long term, you know, situation with Rumble and trying to fight censorship. The problem is, it feels like we were facing a crisis of censorship, and we had people like Dave and Chris be like, everybody, quick, hop on board this safety ship. And then it's like turning around and going right back to Google. It's going right back to big tech and institutional investment. And you're like, we're trying to get away from this. So it's like 3 years of hard work was just erased because we know the path this leads down. And I'm going to stress this point. Everything Ian said about this happened. Mm-hmm. When it came to locals, when it came to local selling, when it came to when it comes to what Rumble was going to do, now he's predicting the big firms will buy up a percentage. I'd be willing to bet Ian's right about this, and I think it's fair to say, considering he co-founded Minds and watched the process of investment coming in. Not that Minds fell.
No, and thank God we stayed private, and Timcast is private. I think private company is the way to go. You can take a private company to the top. You do not need to sell out.
No, great call, by the way. Like the fact that you even saw that coming is pretty impressive.
We didn't think it was going to be in 3 weeks.
Dude,
that's
fast. Dave basically said, hey, Chris, let me sell you locals. I'll take a percentage of Rumble. They're like, cool. And then we'll go public. And I mean, it was like a month that happened. He sold it and then they went public.
I kind of feel like the speed at which it was late October that locals announced it was being acquired by Rumble. And then about a month later, Rumble announced a SPAC with Cantor Fitzgerald to go public. And now they're saying it's a $2.1 billion company. And I'm like, sounds like a cash out to me. Mm. Sounds like creating a massive risk to the users who were looking for people who believed in their rights, their free speech, and we're going to create a space. But you know what? Here's what I said before. I'll say it again. Good for them for being entrepreneurs. They have a right to do what they did. People like the platform, want to use it. Michael Malice was like, you know, look, I needed a space. Dave Rubin offered it to me. I know him and I feel better on here than I do on Patreon. So it works for me. And my attitude is like, I wish we had the millions of dollars to fund our operation for our decentralized tech when all this was going on. Mm-hmm. So that instead of there being a Rumble that says we're going public and we're going to allow, which effectively allows anybody to come in and buy in, which means the bad guys are now, the door is open to them. If we had gone at the same time and we had, you know, the decentralized tech we had, we'd be like, we don't own it. We can't sell it if we wanted to.
Are you looking at like blockchain stuff like for hosting?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
Yeah. Or IPFS stuff like decentralized mesh networking. Yeah, that's a big part of it. I've been thinking about it all morning, like decentralized hosting.
No, that's the way. I mean, that's what we need, right? Like we were talking earlier, somebody in the group downstairs, you know, like if we saw it with, what was it? Parler. If you don't have, you know, access to, they can cut you off that fast. Like, weren't they accessing Amazon servers?
Yeah, Parler was on AWS.
Yeah. And
Amazon shut them down.
Just like that.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, Ethereum is on AWS, isn't it?
I don't know. The ERC-20 network, I don't know where it rides. Right. If it's on a multitude of, ideally now you would have access to a multitude of servers. And if AWS cuts you off, you can immediately, right, within like 10 to 15 minutes, port over your new data to a new server that maybe is in your house. Or I want to make Raspberry Pis and preload the software and sell them as part of the organization.
Dan Bongino is an investor into Rumble. I believe Peter Thiel is too, as well.
Right? I've heard that.
And I think Peter Thiel is fairly opposed to a lot of the wokeness and all that stuff. I mean, he didn't like Gawker. He went after them. He's spoken out. I think I know for a fact Dave is as well. So all of these people I know, you know, have been fighting against authoritarianism and a lot of bad stuff. The problem is you go public, you've opened the door and you said, come on in.
Well, if it's Teal for years. Teal is a Bilderberg board member. I talked to him. I had many interesting conversations with him about that on the YouTube channel. But it's hard because a lot of people put their full faith and trust into a lot of these platforms. And a lot of times they don't know what's going to happen with that huge business, with that huge infrastructure. And that's why I don't put any faith in anything, unless I could trust it. That's why I have my own private business, my own platform, and I'm building that up and have been building that up for over 10 years.
You should never have to trust a person at a corporation. The contract should speak for itself, what the company's... But the thing is, people trust Elon Musk. They want to like him. They have hope for the future because superheroes do exist. So
I was just going to say, for years now, I think I've joked that, you know, Peter Thiel and Musk need to get together and launch their own social network that's going to be a platform people can actually speak on without fear of getting just nixed like that.
If it's decentralized, yeah, but then, like, is it even a platform anymore? That's a good conversation to have.
Thanks for checking out this segment from the Timcast IRL podcast. If you want to watch live, you can check out this channel Monday through Friday at 8 p.m. And don't forget to smash that like button, subscribe to this channel, and if you want more unfiltered and uncensored content with all of these guests, go to timcast.com and become a member. All of these guests you know and love in exclusive segments on our website where we are unrestricted in what we talk about, so you'll definitely not want to miss it. Thanks for hanging out. We'll see you all next time.